Well, hey there, and welcome back. In this video, I'm specifically going to be talking about how I finished Game 3. Now, full disclosure, I'm not actually finished, but I'm getting there. And so I wanted to give you an idea of the direction I'm going with this game, just to lend a little insight on the way I go about thinking about my game design, what I like to make. And hopefully this will inspire you to continue on with this project. Once again, if you want the print and play, the rules, the source files, you can find the link below this video. You can follow right along. This is a single page print and play game, which means you can print it out and cut it out within a few minutes, and you can be playing this game and thinking about how you would make it your own. Really all about helping you level up your game design skills. So, as a refresher, this is the the prototype, the first print and play file, colorful little cards with different shapes, different numbers, and the whole idea of this game is it's a set collection sequencing game based around this balancing mechanic. And my initial inspiration for this was juggling. I was having a conversation and it just popped in. Someone said a game about juggling, and I wrote that idea down like a year ago. And then finally I was brainstorming what I would do for this finish this game project, and it circled back around and I came out with this game, this core mechanic. But in the back of my mind, as I'm making this, I was really thinking about juggling. And that helped me with a lot of the decision-making process, because I was thinking about how these objects interact and what effect they would have if you were literally juggling them. It also added a sense of humor, right? It adds that sort of funny aspect of picturing myself trying to actually juggle these things. Side note, I can juggle, but I can't juggle all the things that are in this game. So the game I'm working on right now from this core skeleton, I'm calling Chainsaws and Chickens, which hopefully you just laughed because I think it's funny. And that's really the feel of the game I want. I want it to be funny. I want it to be light. So all the decisions I'm making are how to make it. So there are decisions to be made, strategic decisions, but they're pretty light and quick. And I'm really designing this for, you know, as a family style game, something that you can play with anyone who can do basic addition. So you're talking 6-year-olds, and also make it so it is a pretty quick, you know, 20-25 minute game. So all those things added up to the decisions that I'm currently making. I'm not finished this game yet. There's still more testing I need to do and a few things I need to tweak and test out, but I am getting close. And once I pass a couple more hurdles, I'm going to be moving on to a more finished version of the design, in which case I'll be done. So let's talk about some of the changes I've made. Probably the biggest change is that I've almost doubled the amount of cards. I'm at about 68 cards right now, and I'm tinkering with that. I think one of the things I realized is that I really want to be able to play this with 4 or even 5 players, and in order to do that, I just needed more cards. So I need more playtest sessions with more people, which is easier said than done, as I'm sure you're all aware. But I'd like to have a game with 5, maybe even try it out with 6 players and see how it goes. My thinking there is this just seems like a game where the more the merrier, you're all kind of in this chaotic balancing game together. And I want to be able to include the whole family in a game like this. And so you might notice these cards look pretty similar. Right now they're all in black and white, but on each one I have items, right? So I have a glass bottle, a bowling ball, a plate, a torch, flaming torch. What else do I have? A juggling ball. A chainsaw, of course, the namesake, and if I have that, then I have a chicken as well. Whoop, let's get him right side up. A chicken. So, instead of the colors and shapes that we had before, now we have these items. And so that's where some of the humor comes in, but also some of the logic. So, for instance, in the skeleton of a game, I said, you know, you can't have dark blue items next to a light blue item, or you'll lose points. So how that works for this game is, if you have a bowling ball next to a glass bottle or a plate, you're going to lose some points for that because the bowling ball is breaking those items. Likewise, if you have a chicken next to a chainsaw or a flaming sword, you're going to also lose some points because, you know, that probably would cause some problems. And so I used some of that logic in order to make decisions of what effect would these cards have. And of course, since I increased the number of cards, I didn't want to just duplicate these cards so there were more of each item. I wanted to make new items. And so I did add some new items, kind of extended the range of things there. And also in doing that, I was able to add some more interaction and some more unique effects in the game. And honestly, where I'm at right now is trying to tweak some of those effects so that they keep gameplay really light and quick, but also make sure that the scoring is equitable, right? That someone could get really good combinations of lower point things and still compete with someone who is able to do more higher valued things. So I'm just gonna talk through each of these items and tell you, you know, their point value, how they score, and how they affect the game. And I think from that, you'll get a pretty good idea. Once I finish this game, it's going to be available on my website, circlecanoegames.com. And so you can, of course, access it there once it's ready. I'm hoping that's going to be before too long. So let's look at the first item, which is a juggling ball, right? The whole idea of this is no one's really impressed with the performance if all they're juggling is a juggling ball. So these are actually minus 1 point at the end of the game, unless you have three, in which case it is worth 2 points each. Next, we have a rotten egg. Rotten egg doesn't score any points at the end of the game, but on the turn that you play it in your act, you don't have to have balance. So this is sort of like a wild card that you can throw in there, and it's worth 0 points at the end. We have an apple that's just worth 1 point by itself. Very simple, right? But there is something else that will affect this later on. Juggling pins, again, a little too traditional to be too amazing for the crowd. So they're only worth 1 point each, unless you have three, and then they're 3 points each. A rotten tomato. This is me experimenting in the direction of getting more interaction. So when this card is revealed in the central draw pile, or when it's played in someone's act, all players must juggle their act an extra time. Juggling is the game term for rotating your cards. So this kind of forces people out of what they were planning to do and, you know, creates a little bit more havoc for everyone when one of those cards gets played. The whole idea is a rotten tomato, you know, that means the audience is throwing up rotten fruits and vegetables at you and you have to work a little harder as a performer. Next, we have a glass bottle. Glass bottle is worth 2 points plus 2 points for every pair that are next to each other. The bowling ball, as I mentioned before, is 3 points, but it's minus 1 point for each bottle or plate that it's next to. The plate is worth 3 points. Of course, you gotta watch out for that bowling ball. A cat, right? Again, this is a humorous element. Can you picture trying to juggle a cat? That would be a problem. But 3 points at the end of the game. But when it's played, or when an item is played next to it, you must rearrange one item in that column. This is one that's gonna still require, I think, a little bit of tweaking. It might just be tweaking in the wording to make sure it's clear what people are supposed to do. But I like the idea where you could play this to your advantage because rearranging things could help you in terms of sequencing things in the order you want. But at the same time, it would be highly inconvenient if you had to reorder things when you didn't really want to. We have a torch and we have a flaming sword. And together, these are the flaming items and there's a flaming item bonus. So all together, you get you know, the points for each item plus the number of torches and flaming swords you have in a row. Next, you have a chicken. Chicken is worth 4 points, but it's minus 3 points for each flaming sword or chainsaw that it's next to. Next up, we have an apple core. This is a card that can only be played on top of the apple. The idea here is you may have heard of performers juggling and eating an apple as they're juggling. And so you started with an apple and you end with an apple core. And so you play that card on top of the apple. And in doing so, that's going to be worth 5 points at the end of the game. And the last item we have is, of course, the chainsaw. And the chainsaw is just worth a flat 5 points. So that's all the items. That's the effects, bonuses, penalties that I have associated with them so far. I think as I'm fine-tuning this game more, I want to balance the idea that it's not just a race to get the highest value cards, that it is possible to get good sequences of lower value cards and compete. That's, I think, the hardest thing to do, to make sure that it feels like multiple strategies could win for you. I do feel like in the coming weeks, as I'm testing this game, I am going to be looking to see if there are ways to add more interaction. Some of the brainstorms I talked about in the last video, I'm thinking about how I could implement those or implement parts of those ideas into the version of the game I have right now, because I don't want there to be downtime as much for players as it's going around, especially in a 5-player game. And so whether there's more continual effects on what other players are doing as different items are played, or if there's other methods of scoring that are more ongoing throughout the game, I think either one of those could benefit the overall interactiveness of this game. So that's an overview of where I'm at right now. As you can see, it's not finished, but I'm getting there. The next version of this prototype is gonna be more colorful for sure. I'm probably going to step up the illustrations a little bit, as well as working on some icons so that you can have a reminder as you're playing cards right on them of what effect they have, what their final score will be, things like that, rather than always having to refer to a chart in order to read that. That's kind of a practical concern of design that I'll be thinking about for the next version of this prototype. But for right now, I'm just gonna carry on doing some minor tweaks of points and things like that to see how the game is affected. It's definitely heading in the right direction. I've played some great games that are lots of fun so far, and I'm really excited about finishing this one. And I'm also excited about what you're working on. So if you have a game that you're working on, one of these Finish This Game projects, or even just one that you want me to look at, I'd love to see it. Leave a comment below. The best way to reach out to me directly is through Instagram or Facebook. You can find me at Circle Canoe. And of course, if you're still here, I'd really appreciate a like and a subscribe. I love making these videos in order to help newer game designers level up their skills. And as I get more subscribers, more likes, the more able I am to do that. So thanks for joining me, and I look forward to see what you're making.